Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Before I start, I would like to warmly thank the government of Kuwait for all their support to research and capacity building in our region through financing different institutions, including the Center for Economics and Finance of the IMF. And I'd also like to really thank Dr. Abdel Hamad and the Arab Fund for their warm welcome and hospitality. And this place actually is really dear to my heart. I have been here several times. And I remember in 2006, we had an ERF conference here, and Dr. Ahmed Galal was sitting not far from where I'm sitting now. And he said something. He said, ERF is conscious of the Arab world. And since then, these words actually have been really sincerely inspiring to me, and all my intellectual contributions since then fall under this citation. So thank you very much, Dr. Ahmed, for everything you do to ERF and to the region. I also hear in the same place that in 2012, during the Oil Curves Conference, that we discussed with Dr. Ahmed about investigating the impact of monetary institutions on eventually economic performance in general. And I'm really grateful because he gave me the opportunity to build what I can really call a dream team. I had the privilege, the pleasure to work with Dr. Ibrahim Badawi, who is really, you know, my master. And I had the pleasure to work with Raimondo Soto. He's really one of the best experts in the field, and it was a pleasure to work with him. We also worked with Russell Kruger. He's a former IMF senior economist and one of the very few experts in currency unions worldwide, and his input and insight for writing the institutional requirement for the GCC currency union that we are working on right now was really excellent. And also Arto Kovanen, again, another IMF former expert. He specialized in reforming monetary institutions and to try to really update and increase their performance. I'm really grateful to all of them and to all members of the team, Mohammed Gwaid, Damiana Bakarjeva, Muazza Bantahar, and above everybody, Hoda Slim, for everything she did, not only on the scientific level, but, you know, helping with all the organizations. She was really very helpful. And thanks, Ahmed, for keeping such good people at ERF. So when we have this discussion about monetary policy and monetary regimes, what we were really, Dr. Ahmed, wanted to emphasize was the institutional requirements. And one can look at it from a very broad perspective, as Dr. Ahmed explained in the opening remarks, but eventually all the accountability, democracy, transparency might fall under the political economy sphere. So we don't tackle it in this paper particularly. What we try to look at is eventually, if we are to redesign the institutional requirement or the institutions from within, from inside, it certainly depends on the type of monetary regime we are implementing. Do we have a fixed regime, floating regime, inflation targeting, and each one of them require a different institutional setup. And this depends as well on the monetary objective. So once we know what is our main objective, then we can move eventually to what is the optimal monetary regime, and then we can design, restructure the institutional requirements toward achieving this objective. For example, you know, which units shall we create in our central bank? What type of training shall we give to our employees? What type of capacity building that they need in order to eventually perform inflation targeting efficiently? What type of market communication we need to have in our central bank to establish a very credible channel and to gain credibility to the central bank? How can we develop different instruments and channels to transmit our monetary policy in many countries? It's mainly exchange rate channel. How can we develop all the others? So that's how we look at it from the institutional point of view. And for this, we have to make some decisions about monetary regimes. Obviously, we have the hard pegs or the fixed regime on one side. We can move gradually through intermediate regimes all the way to floating regimes. So we're going to try to see in our research how these different types of regimes or monetary regimes affect economic performance. And we include in our estimation inflation targeting indicator, which is actually compiled to be different from floating exchange rate regimes. Different. So eventually we have countries like Singapore, like Hong Kong, who adopt inflation targeting, but without having a free float or a flexible exchange rate regime, to try to see how this kind of hybrid monetary policy perform as well, and eventually in our countries. So monetary objectives I'm sure most of you would agree that inflation should be the main monetary objective of central banks. But eventually we might also have growth. We might eventually have unemployment. If I am to talk about Egypt, for example, I would really highly recommend that the main focus of monetary policy should be unemployment. This is the main issue. Certainly within a broad set of mix of policies, institutional requirement, trade policies, small enterprise, all the kind macro policies should have only one aim, unemployment. But if we look at the case of oil exporting countries in our region, GCC and populous countries, maybe unemployment is not the main issue. Don't think that for the GCC at least it's a big problem. Maybe for populous countries like Algeria it might be an issue, and we'll see when we come to our policy recommendation the policies, the monetary objectives that we might define and the way to achieve it might help as well reducing unemployment. Other objectives could be balance of payment issues. We might have some shortage in capital inflows, which is not, again, the case of our countries, especially that they have large reserves and sovereign wealth funds, so balance of payment is not neither an issue. Financial stability, well, it could be an issue for other countries. In our region, they showed a very significant resilience to the global financial crisis. So if we are really to define the two main objectives of monetary policy, it might be inflation or growth. So in the rest of our paper, we decided to really tackle these monetary regimes and requirements based on how they impact inflation and growth. So when we started with Raimundo, we sent him a paper. In the title I write monetary policy in resource-dependent economy. And then he will send me back the paper a few weeks later with changing dependent to abundant. Okay, and then I said, I thought I wrote dependent, so I write it back to dependent. And we ended up having a discussion on, does it make a difference? And we decided to test, actually, does it really matter? And actually, it matters. It matters a great deal if you are abundant or dependent. It matters for growth. And actually, it matters eventually even more if you are dependent on oil out of any other type of natural resource. If we look at the results that we have found, that if you are resource abundant, it's a blessing. It will increase growth, it will have a positive impact on growth, significant. Eventually, if you are oil abundant, it might even increase your growth rate by 1.5 percentage point per year. It goes as well for minerals and other types of natural resource abundance. But when you become dependent, this is actually where the curse is, because then your growth is significantly harmed, especially and only if you are dependent on oil exports. So we had this as a first result, and we presented it in Cairo, and then we decided to even go further. So let me just show you the difference between dependence and abundance. So if we look at the average percentage rate of total natural resources to GDP, worldwide is around 2 to 4%. In our region, in the MENA region, it's way above. It's even twice as much than sub-Saharan Africa, and way above any other region. Well, if we look at our export concentrations, we developed this index, Herfelder Index of Export Concentration, and we made a calculation through Comtrade data. If we look at our region and we compare resource abundance to dependence, we see that for a country like Algeria, for example, they have 22% of the resources, total resources of natural resources, of rent. But when we come to the export concentration, it goes all the way up to 95%. So this is a significant difference between being resource abundant and resource dependent. And the same case for other countries in the region, Iran, Kuwait, Libya, Qatar. But we still have some other examples like Bahrain and like UAE, where despite being abundant in oil, they are not dependent in their export and export revenue on oil. So we decided to have this estimation using two different proxies, one for abundant and one for dependent, to see what is the impact on growth and on inflation. So our research question turned around, does it really matter if the country is resource abundant or dependent on growth? And we have seen the answer is yes, significant. For a country like Algeria, they will have a negative impact if they are dependent on oil, up to 1.6% of GDP per year. Does it matter for price stability and for inflation? We're going to see the results. And as well, can the monetary regime or the choice of a different monetary regime affect the impact of oil dependency on economic performance, on inflation and or growth or not? Is there a particular regime that will eventually mitigate the negative impact of being resource or oil, mainly oil dependent? So I'm not going to go through the details of the numbers. You know, we have done extensive work. We presented the findings of the two models in our workshop in Cairo, and I'm really grateful to Dia Nuruddin for the excellent work he did on providing his feedback. So we have different models, and you're going to see, you know, that it was really very robustly done. And I would like to commend Raimondo as well for the excellent work he did. So the growth model is a conventional growth model, very well presented with all the variables, with the best proxies that eventually you can find in the literature. So we control for almost everything. And that's why I believe in this model, actually, we have much more than a story to tell about monetary regimes. But for the purpose of our project and for this paper, we really focus on this additional set of variables where we include proxies for natural resource abundance, natural resource dependence, and for monetary regimes. So we have the two regimes, the two extremes, fixed and floating, and the intermediate regimes will be the comparator. So all the results that we get for fixed and floating regimes are in comparison to the intermediate regimes. We're going to see if they are superior or not. We did the same thing for the inflation model as well. We included all the variables that you know are available in the literature. And again, we can eventually have other interaction variables with institutional variables to flesh out is resource dependency interacted with some of other variables, and this interaction have an impact on growth or inflation. So we have a lot eventually that we can investigate using these same models, but with a different flavor kind of. So as well, we add our variables of resource dependence and abundance and our proxies for monetary policy. And before we proceed, let's look at inflation in our countries. So here we have some comparator countries. We have high-income countries in blue. We have middle-income countries and low-income countries. Well, of course, inflation in high-income countries, because they have been kind of, almost all of them, having a target for inflation close to 2%. So inflation was low during the last 10, 15 years. But if we look at the case in the GCC, for example, actually inflation was performance was fine. We didn't have a big issue with inflation that we can see from the graph, except at some point for UAE and Qatar, but it was mainly due to bottlenecks, not really something, and it has been corrected afterwards. If we look at the populist countries, on the other hand, populist countries are Yemen, Sudan, and Algeria, and we have the same comparator countries. Well, Algeria as well, starting from the years 2000, have been performing well. They had a lower inflation than the average of low-income countries and middle-income countries, so they have been doing fine. Sudan was off chart for a period of time, and now still high, but with the instability, the political instability in Sudan and the political instability in Yemen, I believe it's a little bit hard to really give any sound policy recommendation at this stage, but still, what applies to other countries, oil dependency and so on, applies as well to Sudan and to Yemen. So if we just summarize the findings of our two regressions, if we look at on the upper side, upper part of the table, actually, this is non-oil dependent countries, and on the lower part would be the oil dependent countries. So in general, flexible exchange rate regimes in our models tend to be associated with lower growth and as well higher inflation. So if in terms of recommendations, in comparison to intermediate regimes, flexible regimes are not optimal. When we look at fixed regimes in comparison with intermediate regimes, fixed have a slightly higher impact on growth, positive impact on growth, and the positive impact comes from the fact that fixed regime lower inflation. So eventually, they will cancel the negative impact that eventually we could get from inflation on growth. So it's, and given that inflation was very low in our country to start with, the impact is not that significant. It's not that they increase growth significantly. It's a little bit slightly higher compared to intermediate regime. Inflation targeting, and you have no significant difference from intermediate regime. For inflation, we have that fixed regimes and inflation targeting both are better in controlling inflation, which is normal. Fixed exchange rate is designed, among other things, to keep inflation low, and inflation target inflation to normally. They have to keep it, it will have a positive role on keeping inflation low. But for oil countries, if we look at inflation, flexible regime will lead to slightly higher inflation. So it's a little bit destabilizing. But again, flexible regimes might have on growth, you know, a better impact on growth than it would have been the case in non-oil countries, and it would be superior to fixed regime and intermediate regimes. So what we can take out of this is eventually some flexibility in the exchange rate might be better for growth. But we have to remember, what exactly is the big issue? It's not growth per se. We have mainly an issue of oil dependency, and it has a significant and heavy impact on growth. It really harms growth. So it's not really having increasing growth. The main issue we have to look at is beyond growth and even beyond non-oil growth. It's actually clearly non-oil export growth. So we really need to diversify not just the economy, we have to diversify the export sector to be less reliant on oil, be less dependent on oil, and get all the benefit of being oil abundant without being oil dependent. And this certainly, you know, diversification policy, this has been emphasized by the IMF in many, many reports and the World Bank and so on. So what we are trying to do here is to contribute to see, okay, so how can monetary policy help the diversification of the economy, which again should be subscribed within a very general framework of targeting this diversification. We have to have a long-term objective, and we have to identify which sectors we would like to promote. Would it be energy-intensive production, like steel or aluminium, so eventually we take advantage of our energy resources? Would it be all what falls from hydrocarbon, all the sophisticated production that we can get out of oil, and we have hundreds of examples. Should it be investing in new types of energy? So eventually being not oil exporters, but being energy exporters and trying to get all the experts and all the researchers and all the producers of new energy technologies to be in our region and to export from our region. All these are policies to diversify, and let's see how we can eventually use our monetary policy to try to achieve some of these objectives, what we call eventually targeting competitiveness, but you know, we don't care about the titles. So how do we really implement this targeting competitiveness? A very important component of competitiveness is the price of our exports. So if we have high inflation, higher than our competitors, we're going to harm our export sector. So one of our main focus should be on inflation. So we have to find to have the right institutional setup in our central bank to be able to control inflation. And the best framework to control inflation is actually inflation targeting. Not to have inflation targeting as a full-fledged monetary policy objective, that's not the idea. The idea is to develop all the IT, the inflation targeting framework and requirements and tools and capacity building to be able to really develop all the transmission mechanisms that will make our monetary policy more efficient and our control on inflation less dependent on the exchange rate channel per se. We have credit channels, we have other channels we have to develop. So for me, in the central bank, but particularly in our region, tackling inflation and having inflation within the range of our competitors, not per se, you know, advanced economies or so, but at least if we define what we are willing to diversify toward and what we are willing to export, so eventually our comparators will be our, you know, similar exporting countries. On the other hand, we do not recommend sacrificing the exchange rate stability. You know, we have seen that exchange rate can be very helpful. But eventually, you know, the exchange rate through exchange rate interventions, so we have, can have the two of them in parallel, have been conducted in a very efficient way, as we have seen in our oil country for a very long period of time. So they know how to intervene and they are familiar with this. But to intervene toward what? Not to toward keeping the exchange rate fixed to, for example, the US dollar or whatever, at a fixed rate. No, the idea, if we are to target competitiveness, is to try to really combine the two numbers of inflation and exchange rate in one operational target that will be the real effective exchange rate, combining both inflation and exchange rate, and to have the exchange rate slightly below its equilibrium value, which is calculated based on the fundamentals of the economy. Why below is actually have two reasons. Calculating the equilibrium exchange rate by itself is difficult. It's not something easy. The IMF provided this in Article 4 consultations, and Dr. Ibrahim is one of the best experts in this field by far. So there is always a margin of error of the estimation, and eventually you might have plus or minus 10% of error. So if you target the equilibrium level, and it turns out that actually your error measure is undervalued, so eventually your exchange rate that you are targeting is 10% above the equilibrium level, and you are not doing anything for your competitiveness, actually you are harming your competitiveness. So by maintaining the exchange rate, if we calculate properly the equilibrium level and given the margin of error below the equilibrium level, it will certainly avoid having any error from one side, and eventually it will even help having slightly cheaper exports to be more competitive, especially that we are starting our diversification and we need to provide our new exporting sector with some, assistance kind of using this equilibrium exchange rate. And all the foundations of this targeting competitiveness could be found in the work of John Williamson of Goldstein, Managed Floating Plus, and Danny Roderick, second best, in, having slight undervaluation. Not under the title of competitive targeting, but eventually the same concept of how to manage the exchange rate regime and monetary policy would fall under these guidelines. So in order to design the appropriate institutional requirement once we have got to these conclusions, we cannot really put the GCC and Algeria, Yemen, and Sudan in one basket, especially that the GCC are aiming at establishing a currency union. And those who know me know that I'm one of a strong supporters of the currency union in the GCC. I hope it will see the light soon. So we decided with Russell Kruger actually to really investigate everything that needs to be done in between now and the creation of the new currency in order to really establish deep financial markets, coordination across countries, macroprudential policies, really from an institutional point of view, how we create all this to try to strengthen the creation of a currency union. And we recommend that between now and then, we don't need to change the exchange rate or to move from the fixed exchange rate, moving from a peg to the dollar to a new peg to the dollar in the new common currency, and eventually taking the time to build the right institutions and the right capacities to conduct monetary policy and inflation targeting in a sound way. So eventually, gradually, after several years, we start moving from the peg to the dollar toward targeting more competitiveness and a basket of currencies, as we explained. And for the case of Algeria, and here Arto Kovanen's help was instrumental, it's a different story, but again, Yemen and Sudan are in political conflict, so we won't really talk too much about them. But for Algeria, in my mind, they are already on their way of targeting competitiveness. We have seen a very high level of consultation in Algeria. So our recommendations will be on how to develop the institutional framework to conduct the sound monetary policy through different channels and so on. As a particular case study, how to calculate the equilibrium exchange rate, why oil countries have their specificity when it comes to choosing the right variables in the model, and how we can really have a very sharp calculation using the appropriate methodology of the equilibrium exchange rate. So I would like to thank Raimondo very much for all the work he did, and if you have any technical questions, don't ask me, ask him, and if there is any glory of the paper, it all goes to him, and thank you very much for your attention.